So let's continue by looking at states and political systems after 1989, how they are established, the format that they take after removing the communist regime, which, by the way, usually was what? A unitary, centralized state, not just unitary, but usually also centralized, even in countries that were federal, like the Soviet Union, or even Yugoslavia, it was still centralized, right? But usually unitary. And understand the difference between unitary, federal, confederal, and centralized, decentralized, which are two different things. Okay, so let's continue this examination with the Czech Republic, right? Of course, we are talking about the Czech Republic now, but what we are talking about, what we should be talking about at this point, 1989, is Czechoslovakia, right? And Czechoslovakia, which is, if you remember from your readings, was composed of, well, a Czech and a Slovak part, but still it wasn't really a federal ring. In 1968, that was one of the demands of the Slovaks, right? To transform it into a federal arrangement, and at first they pushed in that direction, right, after the Prague Spring, but then came the so-called normalization, in which things reverted to the old cold ways. So it became and functioned like a unitary state. So 1989, of course, this again breaks loose. And notice what's going on here, right? The Slovaks, which never had a state in their history, right? They have been, for all their history, part of the Hungarian kingdom, right? And they have been differentiated both through their Slavic language from the Hungarian, and also in terms of class, they usually were the peasants. Fewer of them were part of the nobility. That's, you know, in the Hungarian kingdom. Then in 1918, they become part of the Czechoslovakia, and so on. The point is that the emergence of the Slovak national identity happens in the right in the 19th century, like with all the other groups, right? So Slovaks, Slovenes, right, and others, which never had a state, nor was national identity a matter of, you know, important concern. It's defined, starts being defined in 19th century. But notice, remember our definition of nation, right? A nation is a group of people that share fundamental identification, right? And that can be, or fundamental traits of identification, right? And they can be different. They might be political, they might be ethnic, they might be cultural, they might be linguistic, they might be regional. You know, that differs from, you know, nation to nation, from different groups of this sort. But another thing that is common for something that we call a nation, and makes it different than just an ethnic group, right? Or another group, is that they search, that they claim, in modernity, they claim statehood, or they have political ambitions of self-determination, right? So, the formation of nation building, right, which is a process of defining national identity, of carving out the limits and the boundaries, the framework of what is, what are we in the sense of what are, you know, what is this group, right? What unites, quote unquote, us and so on, right? That's one process, nation building. State building is when you build a state. Now, they are connected, they're not the same thing. And it is part of nationalism and the rise of national the construction of national identity that at a certain point these groups will claim self-determination. Not because it has to be so, there's nowhere written that it has to be so, but it's part of the modern idea that people should govern themselves, famously Woodrow Wilson, right? Well, which people, right? Well, our group, which is our group, okay? So, claiming or getting to claim self-determination, meaning their own statehood, is sort of part of this process of modern rise of the nation, of the state, and of the concept, and here's the key concept, of the nation state, which you see it's two different things put together. Now, for example, think of the UK, the United Kingdom. It's a multinational state. It's composed of England, Wales, Scotland and Northern Ireland, and they call themselves nations, okay? And it's fine, more or less, together, right? It doesn't have to be a nation state, right? There is no such thing as a British nation, or is there, right? Same with Yugoslavia. But in the case of Slovaks, what you need to notice, right, what we can notice is that it's the process of nation building, of quote-unquote awakening national consciousness, as if it were sleeping somewhere, happens, starts in the 19th century, but never gets to claiming its own statehood. Right? That's the interesting thing. This is why studying the Central Eastern Europe is such an amazing laboratory for studying these issues, because this very modern concept of nationalism, right, of nation, of state, right, you can see it happening. And things that start in the 19th century and don't accomplish themselves, right, these nations, or well, Greek groups that claim nationhood but never get to have statehood, then in the 19th century, early 20th century, or after World War I, when many of them, through the fragmentation of the Austro-Hungarian Empire, do get that, well, it's sort of a postponed thing, but that never goes away. And by all this, I mean the fact that the Slovaks, this nation-building process starts in the 19th century, seems to get accomplished in 1992-93, when Czechoslovakia will fall apart, in the sense, peacefully, right, in the famous Velvet Divorce, this thing, the Velvet Revolution, Velvet Divorce, peacefully. So from one state you have two states, one Czech Republic, one Slovak, right? But notice that the same thing will happen also in Yugoslavia, right, because the quote-unquote nations of the southern, among the southern Slavs, which start defining their national identity, just like all the states in the world, by the way, all the nations in the world, right? All the groups define this new identity of nation, national identity in the 19th century. But notice that all of them will share the same thing, that they will never accomplish this process until the 90s. So the wars in Yugoslavia, just like the breakup of the Czechoslovakia, have the same cause. One was peaceful, one wasn't peaceful, for good reasons, and we'll see the reasons. But they both have the same cause. It's this process of nation, claiming nationhood, of nation building, right? That starts in the 19th century but never gets accomplished in the 19th century, nor even at after World War I, when many of these states in the Central Eastern Europe get the shapes that we know today. Romania is formed in 1918, right? So in Yugoslavia, you will have what you will have in the southern Slavs. There was no, you know, they were all part of the either Ottoman Empire or the Habsburgs in the 19th century. Then after World War I, there is this Yugoslavia, but that's still not a nation state, isn't it? It's a multinational state. And you see the power, and this is why it's fascinating to study this. You see the power of this concept, of this principle of national self-determination, of nationalism. Why is it so powerful? Why is it so powerful that it leads to the breakup of states, to wars? Well, just think of the Civil War in the US. It was a war. The reason of slavery was there for the separation, but why don't just let them go? Right? What is this principle based on which one part can tell the other part, oh no, you have to stay with me? You see? It's nationalism. Lincoln was a nationalistic leader. Okay? So the same thing will happen in Yugoslavia and Czechoslovakia, but differently. This is fascinating, because in the same limited region of Central Eastern Europe, we have two cases of nation building and state building that starts in the 19th century and ends only at the end of the 20th century. The Czechs and the Slovaks, right? And then the Southern Slavs. And one results in a peaceful separation and the other one in a bloody conflict, the death of Yugoslavia. Why, right? And we'll see more about Yugoslavia actually this week. Okay, and next week. So, Czechoslovakia is a fascinating case in which this process of nation building starting in the 19th century by this, you know, to both Czechs and Slovaks, but especially the Slovak case, who never had a state, only ends in 1993. And it shows you how powerful it is that when 1989 happens, right, what happens, right? The two major opposition forces in Czechoslovakia, right, were the Civic Forum on the Czech part and the People Against Violence, PAV or PVA, in the Slovak part, right? From the Slovak part, right? And they were two opposition groups, and they basically remove the communist regime, right? And as it happens in the Poland, Czechoslovakia, Hungary, the opposition forces that kind of lead the 1989 transition, the peaceful revolutions, the roundtable talks, the crumbling of the regime, right? in Poland Solidarity, in Czech Republic, in Czechoslovakia, sorry, Civic Forum and PAV, and we'll see about Hungary, right, but still you have very clear opposition groups. So what happens in all three countries is that just like they had a peaceful revolution in all three countries, you will also have a transition in which the opposition forces all get to power, okay? And they will shape the new regime, okay? And that's what happens in Czechoslovakia. And one of the first things they do is to transform Czechoslovakia into a federation. So from a basically a unitary state in terms of how it's functioned, it becomes formally a federation of two republics. So it becomes the Czechoslovak Federative Republic, basically a federation of two republics, right? In name. And then they have to carve out what are specifically the institutions. Remember, Austro-Hungarian Empire. This is much more smaller and still, you know, you have this question, how do you set it up? So which institutions, you know, how you will divide government, right? So, because this will be the Republic of two republics, right? And you need them to establish a common government, but they themselves will have a common government. So which responsibilities go here, which here, which here? It's not, these are, you know, different nations, right? It will be a multinational state. Again, think Austro-Hungarian Empire, right? So it's not just a federal system, but it's a federation of two different, they claim to be nations, right? So, and it doesn't work out. It doesn't work out. And how interesting is this that it doesn't work out? Again, it points you to the power of this principle of national self-determination of nationalism. So what happens in 1993 is that the leaders simply decide, you know what, let's just go. Also because, you know, there it is. These are two national groups, right, that speak literally the same language in very small differences, literally. But historically, they have been very, very different. Right? This part, the Slovak part, has been part of the Hungarian kingdom, usually less developed, mostly peasants, a different culture, a different which shapes them into a different entity. While this part, the Czech part, remember Bohemia, it was one of the most advanced, they benefited from the reforms of the Enlightenment monarchs in the Austro-Hungarian Empire, they were early industrialized, early urbanized, they have a tradition of tolerance, remember an end rebellion, remember Jan Hus and others. So very, you know, this is clearly more westernized, more developed. And that also showed during communism, right? When industrialization happens in the Slovak part, basically during communism, while these, the Czech part, have had industry for a couple of centuries now. So these differences, these cultural, historical differences, they have had statehood, they have not had statehood. They create different identities. So today we can talk about, you know, American nation and Canadian nation, whatever that means. They speak the same language, don't they? Right? So why? Why? Why different? Let's just erase the border and let's all be part of Canada. Oh, that's not good. Why? Right? Don't they speak the same identical languages? Americans and Canadians? So you understand the difference. Okay. So it falls apart. It doesn't fall apart. It's negotiated, just like we had the Velvet Revolution in Czechoslovakia, we will have a Velvet Divorce. And it's important that this is going on at the same time as in Yugoslavia, you have that violent conflict starting. And that actually helps them, you know, divorce in a peaceful way and to form two states. So when we talk about the state, right, we have to go through this transition, you know, from Czechoslovakia as a state into a federal state, Czechoslovakia, into two different states. So the Czech Republic, which we will focus on and continue to focus on, right, Czech Republic, right, becomes a unitary state. It's a small, right, so itself it will become a unitary state. It used to be a part of for a very short period of a federal arrangement, then it becomes in its own a unitary state. And we all know that what that means, so know the definition. And as your book points out, the struggle to decentralize and to give power to local government is an ongoing struggle. Okay. Then the political system. Now here's an interesting thing, because and I'm going to erase this. The political system, the Czech political system, Well, at first look, it should be, and it looks like it is a parliamentary system. And it, for all intents and purposes, it should be, okay? So, remember what are the characteristics of a parliamentary system. In a parliamentary system, only the parliament is directly elected, right? And all the power comes from the parliament, which invests the executive with the power to govern, right? And just like in the UK, right? And another thing is that it separates the functions of head of executive and head of state. And usually the head of state, it's a dual executive in a parliamentary system. The head of state, which can be a monarch in the UK, president in Germany, president in Czechoslovakia, Czech Republic, president in Hungary, it's just a formal, symbolic position, right? The head of state represents the state, has no executive, has no role in shaping policy, making policy, governing the country, running the country. That is the prime minister, or whatever it's called in the given country, right? In Germany it's called chancellor, whatever. The point is the function that that position fulfills. Okay, so this is the most important actor, but most power resides with the parliament. So that's how it should look, right? And usually the president is elected through various means, but not by the population, because remember, whenever a position is elected by the population, that means political power, because power in a representative democracy is supposed to come, the source of power is, you know, the people, through election. Okay? Well, you would say, well, this looks fine, right? This should be probably, they would have a unicameral parliament, because they had the Diet before, remember, historically, and I told you in the previous lecture about Poland, that there are a few sources from which, based on which these political systems inspire, from which these political systems, these leaders inspire themselves, these societies inspire themselves to set up a new political system, and these sources are what is in place. What has been the historical tradition before the dark intermezzo of communism, models from current day functioning democracies, mostly from Europe, or for the impact of the context, of the specific political context, and of the specific political actors in the given country. So these are kind of the four inspirations, four factors that shape political systems. So here's where it becomes interesting that the legislature, which is called the Chamber of Deputies, deputies is a traditional name for elected people, right? Here's the thing. It turns out it's not enough, that they want also an upper house, which is a strange thing. It's a strange thing that they would want an upper house. Usually upper houses are weaker than the lower houses. Usually bicameral systems are not very balanced. This is more power here, less power here. US is an exception among bicameral parliaments, legislatures. So the question, why have a Senate? Why have an upper house? Why, you know, bicameral legislatures? How and why are they formed? Bicameral legislatures need to have a sense, right? And you're gonna say, oh yeah, yeah, it's famous checks and balances, where separation of power. Yeah, but why not five? Why not 74 houses? If they're doing the same job, why pay the same people twice? And actually, currently in Romania, the debate is to cut the upper house. This is just a doubling of the lower house. So why? There's a whole popular movement towards this. So why a Senate? And it's a good question. It is a good question, because usually bicameral systems happen, for example, another reason to have them is when it's a federal state, right? It's a federal arrangement in which the lower house represents the people and the upper house represents the states, meaning not the states, the regions, right? So that's Germany. In Germany, the lower house elected by the people, upper house appointed by the regions. In the US, originally, as it should be, according to the constitution, is that the lower house of representatives is elected by the people, and the upper house, the Senate, is appointed by state legislatures. That was the case for 120 years, okay? Because it's federal. Or another reason to have a bicameral legislature is when, in any case, the point of legislature is to represent something. Why have two things represent the same thing, meaning the people? Why not three? Right? This is why you have to have a reason in which one house represents something, meaning the people, and the other house represents something else, maybe the regions, maybe groups in society. So upper houses also appear where you have significant, for example, ethnic minorities or religious groups or ethno-religious groups or whatever, in which the upper house becomes specifically a house to represent that sort of component, because the state is composed not just by a mass of people but also by units. The US is a United States of America, not United People of America. So the US is a state made of people and of regions, both of them. And if you read the Bill of Rights, you will see that both of them are protected separately. Okay, so they are components of the state. Okay, but in the Czech Republic, what is the point of the upper house? So there was a debate, and there was a debate both because, you know, how, why, and so on. Probably the most important reason was this idea of having two houses check on each other, also because they were coming out of communism where, you know, you had too much power in one set of institutions, maybe, you know. And there was also the worries, here's the context, right? There was a debate about the upper house because the different political parties were worried that the upper house will give an advantage to that political party. I'm going to say, well, how is that the reason? Well, think today that Puerto Rico and DC are not given statehood in the United States, although they arguably should, because there is strong opposition from one of the US parties, which fears that the other US party will be given an advantage because DC will always vote Democrat and whatever. So that's a reason, and it is an important reason. And I don't care which side, whatever. Okay. So back to the system. So it looks and it should be a parliamentary system. It should be a parliamentary system. And yet it is not quite that. And let's see why, right? mostly it's because the head of state is more than just head of state. It also has some head of executive, head of government functions. Head of executive, head of government is the same thing. And you're going to ask why. Well, remember who was the first president, elected president of the Czech Republic, or Czechoslovakia and then the Czech Republic, Václav Havel. And here's the impact of the particular context of the particular political figures. Lech Walesa in Poland, he was trying to shape a powerful presidential position, and then there was a backlash to that because he was the determining factor. And we talked about this in the previous lecture about Poland. Same here, it was simply by the sheer authority that was unmatched by other figures in the Czech Republic in the early 90s that Havel, who was president, had much more authority than his position would have actually given him constitutionally, legally. And it's not like that he wanted to abuse it, or, you know, his temperament was different than Lech Walesa's, right? But by sheer force of personality, it became more than just simple head of state. Formal ceremonial goes around, shakes hands and signs things. You see, seeing Václav Havel led the opposition becoming just that, just a figurehead, it wouldn't sound normal. Making him just the prime minister also doesn't really work, because prime ministers depend on the majority of the parliament, they are dismissed easily. So what do you do with such leaders? Okay. So you see how important the given context and the founding figures are, so to speak. So the president today, and in fact, as a natural, so I would characterize this as a sort of it's a parliamentary system that veers a little bit towards a semi-presidential system. So it's in between parliamentary, it's mostly parliamentary, and in between parliamentary and semi-presidential. Very, very interesting. And this is reinforced by the fact that since 2 years ago, 2012 or 13, yeah, since 2 years ago, the election of the president used to be elected by the parliament. That's what happens, you know, with a large majority, so more than 50, probably two-thirds, right? That's in the parliamentary systems, the presidents are elected by other institutions with a supermajority. And guess what? 2 years ago, they changed that, and the president became directly elected. So you see how they're veering towards a semi-presidential system. So today, Czech Republic has something in between a parliamentary and semi-presidential system by virtue of how it has developed and how it was founded. So the president can sign laws and return laws to parliament, appoints PM after election, obviously meaning, you know, the winner of the election, appoints member of the cabinet proposed by the PM, appoints, and here's the thing, these are all formal, right, because it depends on the who wants the election, who wins the election, who the prime minister nominates, and so on. But also the president appoints other positions in the state, just like in Poland, and that's very important. For example, members of the constitutional court, other official positions, that's important power. And not just formally, he can choose whom, he needs the approval of the Senate, however. Okay, sounds familiar? Right. Deals with foreign affairs, can dissolve the chamber of deputies in certain situations, very rare, very narrow, and is the commander-in-chief of armed forces. Now, the president in Germany, the monarch in the UK, both parliamentary systems are not the commander-in-chief of armed forces. So you see how it's in between what should be a formal ceremonial symbolic, you know, position and something with some head of executive functions. And it seems to move in that direction. Okay, so it used to be elected by the two houses together, typical for parliamentary system, now it's directly elected since 2012. The Prime Minister. The Prime Minister is appointed after each parliamentary election. When there's a majority, the Prime Minister usually is the leader or the candidate of the larger party in the coalition. The President calls that leader to form a government. But here's the thing. If you have many parties and the political life is very fragmented, then it's not clear whom the President should ask to form a government. Right? UK is a two-party system. Basically. So it's always clear that one party has majority, another one doesn't. Most of the times. 99% of that. In Germany, you have a multi-party system, but there's always a clear majority. It's only five parties. So in a multi-party system, like in the Czech Republic, which has many parties, and they always change. And always there's always a new majority, so it's not clear who can you ask to form a government. Because the president has to ask them to form a government and then they need to make a coalition. And here's where the president, even in parliamentary system, will have leeway in choosing. Because otherwise, if it's clear, a clear majority, you know, he kind of has to appoint that. So implicitly, just like in Italy, which is a parliamentary system, the president shouldn't have much power, but because it's such a fragmented multi-party system, the president has an important role in choosing whom to ask to form a government, to form a coalition here. Right? Because forming a government means what? It's forming the coalition, a majority coalition here, which gives you the right to the positions in the executive. Okay, so the PM is actually still, right, the main engine of policy, right, in the Czech Republic. Here's the parliamentary part, right? The PM makes the policy, PM gives the direction of the country. But you see that the president has some impact and so on, and the current president actually wants to have more. PM shapes, makes policy, appoints ministers, then president kind of, nominates, okay, president approves, runs the government, organizes the cabinet, and most of the laws come from here as in typical parliamentary systems. Chamber of Deputies, as I said, directly elected by the population, which has to approve the PM and the cabinet, can remove the PM and the cabinet through a vote of no confidence, as, you know, is usual in parliamentary systems. And notice, however, that only the Chamber of Deputies can appoint, I mean, the formation of the executive only depends on this house, not on the Senate. So this is the most powerful house. You have to have a majority here to be able to form government in the executive. And also it's only the Chamber of Deputies that can remove the executive to a vote of no confidence. And has more power than the Senate in passing the laws. The upper house is weaker than the lower house. We're going to talk about how each of them are elected and so on. What its function is, let's say the law is introduced here, then it goes to the Senate and it can debate, amend bills that come from here, right? They're passed by this house, move here. Can it reject bills? Because that's the test, right? That's the test. In the US, right, each house has to pass on its own, they don't go from one to the other, on its own they have to pass identical bills, right? So it's a very balanced bicameral system. This is not that balanced, the lower house is more powerful. The upper house can tweak, adjust, and so on. It can reject bills, but the lower house can pass it with absolute majority, just like in Poland, right? And remember, absolute majority doesn't mean 50% plus one. Majority means 50% plus one. Absolute majority of a parliament, of a house of legislature means 50% plus one, so absolute majority, means 50% plus one of what? That's the question. Of the total of seats. And you're going to ask, so well, yeah, that's obvious. No, it's not obvious. There are about 200 members in the lower house, 200 seats. Which means that in order to have absolute majority, you have to have 101 voting for a bill. And you're saying, okay, that's majority. No, that's absolute majority, because majority as such is majority of the people present. So, because you don't have to have all 200 people to pass a vote in any legislative chamber in the world. You know, you have to have a quorum, you have to have a minimum, which is, I don't know, 60% or something of them. So when 180 are present, only 91 is a majority. Absolute majority is 50% plus one of the total of seats, not just those present. And if they're sick, it doesn't matter, right? Okay, so that's how they can bypass a rejection of legislation by the Senate. However, just like in other systems, the Senate has veto power in some important laws. Amendments to the Constitution, international treaties, matters of defense and security, the Senate has veto. So, Senate does not have veto in normal legislation. It can reject it, but can be again passed by the chamber. But it has veto in matters of amending the Constitution, national security defense, international treaties. Okay. And also, Senate approves certain appointments to certain key positions, constitutional court, judges, and so on, international agreements. So it has some power of advice and consent, right, just like in the US. And you see some similarities with the US, and if you see them, it's good, because, you know, why call it a Senate? Not that the US has invented the name. No, it goes back to the Romans. But this idea of that's the Senate that approves appointments to the Constitutional Court and other appointments, and the fact that the Senate is actually elected, we didn't talk about elections, but just to mention quickly, because we will later, they're elected for 6 years, and a third of them is renewed every 2 years. Well, sounds familiar? Yes. So there might be, we talked about models, they might have taken a look at the US as well, but although the US has not been a model for Central Eastern Europe or for European states in terms of how to set up political systems in general. Nobody chooses presidential systems like the US has. Okay, so that's a brief overview of the Czech Republic as a state and political system. And then the next one, two lectures, will be on Hungary and Romania state and political system.